Welcome back in Geico Outkick Studios. The loathsome, as he does every single Monday, the loathsome Joel Klatt, who had, to be fair, an unbelievable game to call in an unbelievable situation. So we talked about this a little bit last week, but for people out there who missed it or weren't aware, we had Pac-12 breakfast literally from the Coliseum. Game starts right at 9 a.m. on the West Coast. What did it feel like to be there calling what ended up being a fantastic game, especially if you're a Trojan fan, because it looked like the USC had totally lost it. They come back to win. What did it look like from your end to be calling that game? What was the experience?
This is the frustration for me about all the people that were like, I can't believe they're doing this. It's like, Clay, once you're at a game, do you ever really know what time it is?
No. That's a great point.
No, you don't. You don't. You know what time you're leaving the house, and that's it. Then everything becomes on a different type of clock, right?
Yep.
And so I had no, to be honest with you, once I was at the stadium, it didn't make a difference to me at all. You know, I stayed up in a hotel in L.A.
Oh, so you did. That was one of the first questions we said. Are you going to be, are you driving in from the O.C. where you live? Or were you going to stay? So you got a little bit extra sleep and stayed at a hotel in L.A.
And more so, it's just that, like, we're currently renovating our house. And
yeah.
So I don't have a great place to work. And Friday night is a big work night for me. You know,
right.
I sit in the hotel rooms and just, like, pour over notes and all those different things. So I went up there to do that. But anyways, you know, I leave the hotel. I got a coffee and showed up. And I mean, like, you know, Clay, it's fine. And at that point, you know, the motorcade comes by, and so the buses with the police escort comes by. And from that point on, everything was fine. The players were jacked up. The pregame, there was energy down on the field. You could hear them. I mean, it was way more distracting that there were no people in the stadium than the time the game kicked off. Let's
right.
just get that out of the way.
So what did you learn about SC since you were there calling it? I mean, they were very fortunate to win that game. How good are they, or are they just, is this just what SC does, right? I mean, they just that's like been the story for the last decade, it feels like.
They are a slightly better team than they were a year ago, you know, and I think that's good. It's not great. I think that this is a game they would have lost a year ago. I think that their quarterback Keaton Slovis showed an immense amount of patience because that, you know, ASU, and this is, by the way, this is what's happening in the SEC. For those of you that are college football connoisseurs at all, you know that Mike Leach's offense, the air raid offense, and you know, USC runs a very similar version of that with a protege from Mike Leach, Graham Harrell, the offensive coordinator. The way to stop that offense is play – you know, deep, soft zone coverage.
Yeah.
And just put your eyes on the quarterback and make him make a decision, because there's not really great spacing within that offense. They constantly read progressions. They don't do a good job of bracketing defenders and zone defense. And there's not a timing mechanism with when to throw the football for a quarterback. So, you know, it becomes difficult versus zone. This is what the SEC has done ever since our boy Bo Pelini decided to play man in week one. And everyone's like, yeah, that's
yes.
not the way you do that. Jimmy Lake has been doing this for a long time at Washington against Washington State, which is one of the big reasons why the Huskies have always had such great success against Mike Leach. And that's what Arizona State was doing, okay? So I'll give you that backstory to tell you, like, Arizona State was just playing this soft zone, and it was really frustrating for USC. The one part of their game that I knew had to get better from last year, and to be fair, they knew too, is their run game. Because when a defense is going to do that, Clay, you've got to basically run them out of it. You know, if they're going to play soft, you've got to have the ability to hand the football off and tear them apart in the run game and get them to commit more resources closer to the line of scrimmage. That you got to get them to rotate to a single safety, not two safeties. All of those things that are just kind of football 101, and USC just didn't do a great job of that until late. You're going to look up and you're going to see a decent yardage game, but to be real honest with you, they didn't have a lot going because of the game plan that Arizona State had. Now, having said that, Keaton Slovis was really patient the entire day, and then all of a sudden in the last series, they get the onside kick. Guess what they do, Clay? They run the ball. And like, boom, pop a couple of runs, and then, of course, the safety moves over to the middle. They commit more resources to stopping the run, and they hit the seam on fourth down, and they win the game. So, it was a good win for them. I don't know how good they are, but here's the thing. That was their toughest game. Clay, yeah. That's their toughest game on their schedule. Like, there's a good chance USC goes undefeated.
It's going to be interesting. Sorry, and I'm going to get back to that in a sec with you because we're going to talk big picture college football. But, all right, so you called that game. I'm assuming that meant that you were home and able to watch Notre Dame play against Clemson. Notre Dame had been, and you know this, and anybody out there who's a college football fan knows, they had been unable to make plays, right? They just, whenever they played a top five opponent, they had gotten exposed. And what stood out to me, Joel, about this game, and everybody's going to focus on DJ Uiagalelei, or who eventually I'm going to be able to say his name, all right? And the fact that he threw for over 400 yards.
Uiagalelei.
All right, so eventually we'll be able to I'll be able to say his name. But they threw the ball great, Clemson did, but they got dominated on the lines of scrimmage, which we haven't seen from a Notre Dame team on the offensive and defensive line. So a lot of people are going to focus on Trevor Lawrence not being there. But to me, this was a game that Notre Dame won in the trenches. Eventually goes into double overtime. What does this tell us about the game in general and about the playoff picture in general in your mind?
Great question. Okay. So first off, it should be noted that Clemson was down not just Trevor Lawrence,
that's
but
right.
three of their best defenders that they have.
Yes.
Skulski, who's kind of their captain, the linebacker. I believe Tyler Davis, one of their best defensive linemen. And there was one other guy, and forgive me, it's early out here. I'm just spacing his name. But three very good defenders. Very good defenders. And so it's not lost on me that two of those goes, all three of them, by the way, are in the defensive front seven. And Notre Dame really beat them up with the run game. So, yes, Notre Dame made plays in the passing game. There's no doubt. But Clay, they ran the ball incredibly well against Clemson. And I think that was the biggest key. If you go back to the playoff game with Ohio State last year in the semifinal, one of the reasons why Ohio State had such an amazing first half was that J.K. Dobbins was healthy. He hadn't hurt his ankle yet. And Ohio State was doing what? Running the football. Even in the championship game, while Burrow got his yards clearly, Clyde Edwards-Helaire had a nice night. You know, so you have to do that against Clemson if you're going to beat them. They're very talented, and you've got to be able to run the football and control the game to that extent. And by the way, it shouldn't have gone to overtime. Yeah, like Notre Dame played well enough to win the game by 10 points, but they had several miscues, some turnovers in the red zone. You know, Notre Dame played a great game. They really did. And they should be given a lot of credit. I thought that the biggest difference in this Notre Dame team and the Notre Dame teams of, let's say, 2 years ago in the playoff, or even, 12 when they got routed by Alabama, I thought that the biggest difference was what you're talking about, that they could sit there and throw blows at the line of scrimmage and they were not overmatched. They were overmatched a couple of years ago against Clemson at the line of scrimmage. They were overmatched at the line of scrimmage against Alabama. And then clearly they didn't have the speed and the talent on the outside, to make those plays. I still don't think that they're as talented at the skill positions as some of these teams at the top end of college football. But make no mistake about it, they're physical enough to sit there and go toe-to-toe with them. And I think that's a big, revelation, if you will, in this season. Now, what does it mean for the playoff? It's really bad news for everybody else in the playoff. Here's why. If Notre Dame splits with Clemson,
yes,
and Clemson comes back and wins the ACC title, Clay, I think they both go. And then Bama and Ohio State, I think, are pretty clearly the best teams in their conference. And unless Bama loses to Florida, you've got your four teams.
I think you're right. I think you just broke it down perfectly. Now, I would say the complicating factor for Notre Dame, you can't say that they all only have to win the remainder of their games. And by the way, there's Irish fans listening to us right now like, oh, we got to play against Boston College. They're thinking back all the way to 1993, which I remember when Notre Dame upset Florida State. For those of us out there who remember the Charlie Ward era Florida State Seminoles with Bobby Bowden.
Warwick Dunn was on that team.
That was a fantastic, fun team to watch. 1993, the next week, what happens? They go lose to Boston College. And so that was a big turn. That's the last time Notre Dame beat a number one overall ranked team in the Fighting Irish in Notre Dame, right? So when you think about that, the one wild card I would say is if Florida were to beat Alabama, and the other game I want to talk about with you, Joel, is we talked about this last week. I said I love Florida to win this game. I just don't think Georgia has the horses on the offensive side of the ball. I think if you look at Pitts, I think if you look at Tony and what Kyle Trask is able to do, this Florida team has a good enough offense. And I know Alabama's got a great offense too, but they can get a shootout and they can win that game, right? I think Florida will be 9-1 when they roll into that game against Alabama, and they'll have a puncher's chance like anybody does who has a great offense, that if they hit some big plays and they can keep pace with Alabama on the offensive side of the ball, which a lot of teams can't.
I think that that's absolutely accurate, and I think that's why Nick Saban has gone the direction that he has with his program. You know, because you know, when I see Georgia, I see a team that hasn't evolved offensively. They're a team that is stuck in 2013. Kirby Smart is stuck in his, I'm the defensive coordinator at Alabama, and we can run it and play great defense and win the national championship. And dude, that doesn't work anymore. It just doesn't. Even Nick Saban came out, what was it, last week? I'm losing my days, but like last week he talked about how, you know, it's not a defensive game anymore. You can't dominate on the defensive side. As evidence, look at what LSU did offensively last year.
That's right.
Look at what, you know, the Clemson-Bama national championship games have been high scoring, in particular the ones with Deshaun Watson. Look at what Alabama had to do to beat Georgia in the national championship game. They had to put a quarterback in there that could sling it around. And that's when Tua goes in there in the second half and wins the national championship. Georgia doesn't have that ability. You know, Stetson Bennett's a fun story. But you're not going to win the SEC with Stetson Bennett. You're not going to win a national championship, certainly. And Florida at least has that type of team that can go out there and get into a shootout and potentially win. Now, I'd still be way more nervous for their defense against a team like Alabama. I don't think there would be any reason why I wouldn't expect Alabama to score 50 points on Florida, right? I mean, let's be honest. Alabama's offense is that good. So, you know, the Gators would have to have a historically good offensive day. The other team that I would just throw out there that I think is so interesting is Texas A&M.
Yeah, that's right.
They'll be sitting there and likely, and they've looked, you know, they've looked really good, by the way,
yep,
since that loss. They're likely to be 9-1 with their only loss to Alabama. And I believe that, correct me if I'm wrong, that was in Tuscaloosa, correct?
That's right. And so here's how I would set up the college football playoff picture right now. I think you're right. I've kind of broken it down. I got Alabama and Ohio State very likely to get in. It would be a tremendous surprise if either of those teams were not in the college football playoff. Let's put it that way. Clemson, I think, will come back and beat Notre Dame with Trevor Lawrence in the ACC championship game.
But Notre Dame's more in the driver's seat. Let's
Correct.
Be honest.
There's
right?
no doubt.
Notre Dame's Clemson's in the driver's seat for a spot.
Clemson has truly got their back against the wall in the context that they haven't been in a while, where they have to win out, right? They don't have any more margin for error. And then I think the other teams, so I still am anticipating that Clemson will win. For that fourth spot, who I've got in the mix, Florida, Texas A&M, no particular order, Notre Dame. If you're an Oklahoma State fan, they'd have to win out, right? If some of the other craziness happened, they're the only team from the Big 12, I think, that really has a chance to get in. And then for the people who are up early with us that are Pac-12 fans right now, now that the Pac-12 is finally back, if an SC or an Oregon went 7-0, whoever the Pac-12 champ is, those are basically the only teams that are alive to me for the college football playoff. Now, we have a big listenership in Cincinnati. We got a big listenership with BYU fans in Utah. I'm sure you guys are going to blow me up on Twitter and argue, and you're probably going to come after Joel Klatt too, but I just don't see those either of those teams. Or, by the way, Liberty or Coastal Carolina, the teams that are crazily, I mean, this is one of the craziest top 25s we've ever seen. One of those teams may well go undefeated as well.
Yeah. I think that you're right. We need to come to the realization, and good for them, BYU is going to go undefeated.
Zach Wilson is incredible.
Like, He's incredible. And Kalani Sitake, their head coach, I am a huge fan of his. Clay, I don't remember if you were, you know, think back to when we used to do those shows, you know, on FS1.
Yep.
I was talking about him way back then when he was the defensive coordinator at Utah. I've liked him for a long time, and he's done a remarkable job at BYU, and good for him.
Yep.
I like what they've done. They're programming. They only have two more games left. You know, Eastern, you know, something, blah, 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 Southwestern of Toledo or Michigan or whomever. And then they've got San Diego State. I think that San Diego State is an interesting one. They're trying to get more games on the schedule so that they can stay on the forefront. How about this for an interesting, you know, kind of subtext of the season? Did you know that BYU is actively still trying to schedule games for this year? Isn't that incredible?
It's incredible. Let me also say this. BYU deserves a tremendous amount of respect from college football fans out there because they were the only school in the Mountain Time Zone or the Pacific Time Zone that had the stones to start the season on time, right?
That's
everybody
right.
else in the Mountain Time Zone, I know Air Force had a couple of games on the schedule because I get blown up by Air Force people when I say that. But the entire West Coast, the only school that was trying to play a full schedule in early September and never really wavered from it was BYU. And so I enjoy watching their success.
They had to make an entire schedule.
That's right. Everybody quit on
them. Notre Dame as an independent that got to like kind of fold into the ACC.
That's right.
Right? Like they created this from scratch, everybody. Like this is a remarkable season. So I'm with you. They should be given a tremendous amount of credit. Cincinnati's a really good football team. I don't want to just write them off. I would just say, and to be fair to history, because I've always said this, is that these mid majors, these group of five schools, they just don't get tested. I'm sorry, but as great as the story is, they are not undefeated if they play in the Big Ten or even in the Pac-12 or the ACC or the SEC. It doesn't happen. People get so mad at me for this position, Clay, but it's just accurate. I'm sorry, but that's an accurate assessment of college football.
All right,
I would just say this. This playoff race is going to be as interesting as we've ever seen because everybody's going to have different amount of games. And the last thing I want to say is that the biggest wrench could be the fact that there were thousands of kids on that field at Notre Dame. And I'm not here to tell you that I was like, oh my gosh, what's going on? I'm just here to tell you if the cases spike for Clemson or Notre Dame, and they start losing games, or Clay, they start getting hit even harder on their depth charts, and then lose one of those games, like you were explaining in '93 against Boston College. That's the other wrench to this whole playoff scenario that we haven't discussed yet.
Yeah, it's interesting, and they put out a statement for Notre Dame students in the wake of, I'm sure, getting a lot of negative attention. But I first of all, I talked about this in the first hour. If you are going to be opposed to all gatherings of large groups of people, that's your right. I disagree with you, right? I mean, I had a Halloween party at my house. I went to my third NFL game yesterday. I went to the Tennessee-Alabama game in Neyland. Like, I am of the opinion that you have to start to live your life, right? But the fact that many of the Corona bros, as I call them, were praising all the celebrations surrounding the political results and ridiculing the Notre Dame students for storming the field, like, you have to at least be consistent in your positions. You can't adjust it based on whether you agree with the reason that somebody is joyful, right? Like, if you have to be consistent.
Right.
Clay, like, that's all I'm asking
and
for.
By the way, though, should we expect anything different? Because most of these were the same exact people that were saying that college football was going to kill everybody.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
It, and then they're tweeting from the press box about how great it is. Look at my office for the night. It's like, you know, give me a break.
And it is remarkable.
Their credibility for the future, a lot of these people, has been decimated during this. It just has. And I think that's a reality that all of us can at least look in the eyeballs.
It's amazing to me the number of people who are in media and argued on social media obsessively for months, it's not safe to play football. And then I see them tweeting from inside of football stadiums. If it's not safe to play football, how is it safe for you to travel and cover it? Your job matters way less than anybody who's on the field, right? Like, so you are a luxury.
If that's your opinion, and if that's your opinion, great. That is perfectly fine. And you know what? I celebrate that that's your opinion. But doesn't that make you more of a hypocrite and more cavalier? If you think it's that dangerous and then you continue to travel, that's more egregious.
Amen. I agree. I agree 100% there.